All right, we are here today with Dr. James Franklin. We are actually at the Science and Technology Museum, 2380 Lancaster Road. It is July 8, 2015, and the interviewer, as usual, will be William McRae. So here we go. Could you please state your full name?
Put in my middle name?
Sure.
James McWillie, Scottish background, Franklin.
And your age?
72.
And where were you born?
North Bay, Ontario.
Okay. And what did your parents do? Actually, we'll start. Where did your parents come from?
Well, my mother came from Scotland and came over just after the First World War with part of her family. The rest hadn't been born yet. And my grandfather, who had fought in the First World War, got gassed at Ypres, didn't want to be a tenant farmer in Scotland anymore, came over, started farming in the Niagara Falls area between Welland and St. Catharines, and did that for the rest of his life. My mother was born there and became a nurse. And my father was born in Maxville, Ontario, just out to the east of us here. And he and his entire family of four all went to university, which was remarkable in those days, considering that his father died when he, as oldest of the family, was only 10. And he was a high school teacher. It turns out that, remarkably enough, I could never figure out for many years how my grandmother managed to afford to send four kids all through university until I discovered that her name before she was married was Booth. And that was part of the lumber company family. Yeah, and okay. So she had inherited some money as part of that. And so that was an interesting background.
They use it for good?
Yeah, so it turns out that my dad's side of the family had a very long history in eastern Ontario. And his ancestors came over from England in the 1600s. Apparently, they do have a family tree somewhere. And the Booth side of the family, of course, became the lumber company and was what established Ottawa. So
your dad was a high school teacher?
Yes, he
was. What did he teach?
Taught history. Yeah, history and English. And he eventually realized that there were thousands of history and English teachers, so he did a commercial specialization and taught bookkeeping and accounting mainly and things like that. But his real passion was history.
Yeah, as many of us.
Yeah.
And your mother?
My mother was a nurse. Okay. And she moved to North Bay because at that time, I guess in the early Depression, the hospital in North Bay paid trainee nurses better than any other hospital that she could find. And being Scottish and careful, she decided that was a good place to go. So she went to North Bay and did her training, met my dad through some church club that they both belonged to, and got married. And so then eventually I came along. So.
And how many siblings?
None.
Only child?
Yep.
Okay. That's pretty rare for that
time. It is, actually, at that time, but that was what they decided to do.
Okay. So, yeah. So what did you do as a child? As pastime or interests?
Like most kids, I guess, got into a lot of trouble. You know, I mean, it's interesting because I was always interested in science, and I think a lot of that has to do with teachers that you have. And I had, in both public school and in high school, but particularly in public school, some really excellent science teachers who got me interested in electronics, actually. And that's why I thought of going into electrical engineering and actually started out that way. So I used to build radios and do things like that and disrupt our television set and do lots of stuff like that.
What was the big movement at the time or electronic?
The big thing at the time was, of course, the beginnings of space and the Sputnik, the Russians put up and the Americans following close on. All of that was so new, and the development of tiny transistor radios, only this big, you know, and the, quite frankly, the advent of television. I mean, you know, we didn't have television until I was in, I guess I'd probably been in high school. I can remember seeing the Ed Sullivan Show on Elvis Presley as some of the earliest TV that we got in North Bay. The whole electronics world that came on was a new threshold in science. And you know, there were a lot of us that were very enthused by that. The whole business of getting away from wires and being able to do things with tiny electronics, and then going to space.
So that was as of high school, you were very interested?
Yeah, as high school, and I went off to study electrical engineering for 1 year and discovered that that's not really what I wanted. And you know, when you look at people in geoscience, I would bet you that at least a half, if not two-thirds of them, started out the same way, going into something different, some other branch of science, discovering geology was what they were really interested in, and shifting over to it.
Yeah. It's true, though, when you think about it, when you look around, not a lot of young people go into geology immediately,
no.
or think of geology as a profession.
In North Bay, it wasn't even offered in high school. I mean, there was no way one would get any background in geology whatsoever. If you took a geography course, you might get a little bit, but I didn't, because I was going to go into electrical engineering. So I did physics, chemistry, and math, and French, two Frenches actually, and Latin, and English literature and composition, that kind of thing. That's what you did, and you didn't. You streamed yourself to go into what we call the hard sciences, and I didn't even do biology. And I may have done it in grade 12, but not in grade 13, and because I wasn't interested in it, you know. And that I think it kind of dictated where you're going to go. The other thing is that coming from a relatively small town, the quality of teaching varied some, and so you were very much affected by those teachers who were really good at what they were good at, and not so affected by those perhaps who were
agreed
dull. Mm-hmm. that's what happens.
So where did you go to school for geology once you decided?
Carleton, actually. I decided to go to Carleton primarily because it was the closest university to North Bay, and I switched and went there. Actually, that's not quite true. To tell you the truth, I did my first year at Laurentian in Sudbury, and they had no second year. So they were just starting the university.
Okay.
And they had not built the campus that they're on now. It's interesting because I was up there the other day and they didn't realize that I was a graduate of sorts. I'm not really, because I only did first year. And you know, I was the only student in geology at Laurentian that was a declared major. The others that were taking the course were in other fields of science. And I was lucky in a sense that the guy who was teaching it was actually, as it turns out, a geophysicist, a Harvard-trained geophysicist. He'd been hired there because he could teach both math and geology. And so he did. And as his only student, he made me his TA, so I helped set up the labs and do all that stuff. So I got enormous education in first year from this guy, because he kind of took me under his wing. And we've been friends ever since. He left and joined the Geological Survey soon after I moved to Carleton. And over the years, he became head of SOQUEM, which is the big Quebec government exploration company, then started his own geophysics company, which still operates today and out of Quebec City, and he's now retired and out prospecting. Edwin Gaucher, his name was. Mm-hmm. Son Pierre now runs GDD as the company, and they make geophysical equipment. Okay. But Edwin was a wonderful mentor, and he's still around, calls me his only student. So I did first year at Laurentian, realized that they didn't have a program, switched to Carleton, into second year, and finished up through Carleton, stayed on, did a master's at Carleton, largely because I was probably too lazy to go anywhere else, and I had had a summer job my second year. My first year in geology, I worked for International Nickel, now Vale out of Sudbury, interesting experience. Second year, I thought I'd just like to work closer to home. There was a company called Geophysical Engineering and Surveys Limited in North Bay. It turned up at their door at Christmas, said, "You hire any students?" They said, "Well, we need one." They hired me. It turned out they had a small mine at Tomogamy called Copper Fields, or Tomogamy Copper. And as it turns out, that company was started by a professor at the University of Toronto whose name was Norman B. Keevil. Norman B. Keevil went on to found Tech Corporation. So I worked for them that summer. Norm Sr. was the president of the company. He had just left U of T and was trying to make a go of this small mining company, found this mine using a very elementary but interesting geophysical method, found this little copper mine on an island in Lake Tomogamy. It was incredibly high grade, direct shipping ore right to the smelter in Noranda. And so I got a summer job there, basically out helping a prospector prospect and do a little mapping and learning some of the things, running geophysical equipment, that sort of stuff. Excellent experience. Some years later, I got curious about the deposit and went back and did my master's thesis on part of it. And that was a great experience for me. And not only that, but by this time, Norm Sr.'s son had finished his Ph.D. at, I think, at Berkeley or Stanford in theoretical geophysics, and was now moving up in the company. And a when I finished my master's thesis, the two of them went over it with me, which was quite an interesting and somewhat sweaty experience, because two very brilliant guys. And Norm Jr. now is chairman of the board of Tech, and a chap we really should interview if you ever get the chance. And they were tremendously supportive. And remarkably enough, about 6 or 8 months ago, I was at a conference, and a friend of mine who's a prof at Colorado School of Mines had his students with posters at the conference, and one of them was my young lady, the last name of Kimo, turned out was a niece of Norm Sr.'s, and she immediately called up Uncle Norm, who remembered me. And I gave her an old copy of my thesis because she spent some of her summers canoeing in the Tamagami area. The Camp family still has cottages there. Anyway, very interesting place to be, and I did. So I did my master's at Tamagami, and then I decided I'd do a Ph.D. and I started to shop around for various schools. Came very close to going to the United States, but I had, through extremely good luck, after third year, where I'd worked for Hollinger at that time, I went on a field trip which was run by the CIM in out of Noranda, and it was the first ever field trip to an area called Matagami Lake in Quebec. I pitched up for this thing. It was in early September, just before classes started. I was the only student. Nice bunch of guys. I didn't know any of them. I went off on this trip, and we went up by bus to Matagami. First night, we're all in the bar at the Matagami Lake Hotel having beer. Everybody's ordering around the table. I take a look at the wallet. If I had ordered a beer, I wouldn't have had enough money to buy dinner. So I said to the guy next to me, "You think the bartender will cash a check?" He said, "There's not a hope, boy." He said, "What's your problem?" I told him. He said, "Oh, students don't buy beer. Go to the washroom. I'll get the guy next to you to buy it." And it turned out that the guy I was talking to, who I didn't know at all, was with the Geological Survey of Canada. They told me, "Cash in your air ticket. We'll drive you back to Ottawa," which I did. And on the way back, I asked him about summer work, and he arranged for a couple of interviews for me, and I picked up summer job working for one of his colleagues, and that completely changed my career because I got into research right there, working with an absolutely phenomenal chap by the name of Stuart Roscoe. The guy who set me up was Joe Chamberlain. These were very senior people at the Geological Survey, who it was like going to a university with no students, in a sense, working in the Geological Survey. These were curiosity-driven researchers who were working on mineral deposits problems all over the place. And so I went to work for Stu after third year, and then they supported me on my master's thesis to give me the time to do some of the work, and then they set me up on a PhD thesis. Well, I defined it and set up the potential project and wrote a proposal, which was reviewed by the chief geologist of the day. Another frightening experience, because I had to appear in front of him. He'd been chief geologist in the 40s and didn't actually talk to students. And then C.S. Lord, Cliff Lord, but he roped his way through my proposal, talked to my colleague Stuart Roscoe, and said, "We haven't had anybody in Thunder Bay since T.L. Tanton in 1932, but you proved it," and I got my fully funded PhD thesis done through the Geological Survey. And then it was a study of the mineral deposits of the Proterozoic rocks of the North Shore of Lake Superior. And that became a lifelong hobby also as a result, of course, because it was a fascinating topic. And I had all these wonderful individuals at the Geological Survey giving me advice, as well as my PhD supervisor, of course, at Western, and I went to Western for my PhD.
Okay. What was your first official job throughout career job?
Well, what happened was that when I was finishing up my PhD, I thought, gosh, I got to get a job. I got married the year before I finished. My wife already had a PhD and was doing her second postdoctoral fellowship at Western. I thought I'd go into industry. So I lined up and was offered several fascinating jobs with industry, every one of which said, "We're going to send you to an office someplace or other to cut your teeth and learn about it. But then we want you to move back to our head office in Toronto and become a manager." And I thought, I didn't do a PhD to become a manager. I did a PhD to do science. And on the spur of the moment, I knew that Lakehead University was looking for an economic geology professor. I phoned up the chairman, who I'd met when I was doing my research up there. Next day, went for an interview. They offered me the job that day. Wow. And so I took the job. My wife and I moved to Thunder Bay. She ended up creating a job for herself at one of the local hospitals and worked
at a PhD
in physiology.
In physiology.
Yeah. And so she became head of the School of Medical Technology, which is now run by the community colleges, but then wasn't, and had a joint program, degree program at the university. So she did that. And I spent my first 6 years of my career there as a prof. Thoroughly enjoyed it, got into some fascinating research, and realized that at a small school with no graduate program, there was a limit to where you were going to go. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, I kept in close touch with my friends at the Geological Survey. They created the job of my dreams for me, which was called the Regional Metallurgist of the Southern Precambrian Shield. So my field area was Chibougamau to the Saskatchewan-Manitoba border with the Northwest Territories. I could do whatever I wanted as long as I did interesting projects that resulted in useful information and publications. So I had, it was an enormous opportunity. So I moved back to
Ottawa. Very open for you to do that.
Very open, and I worked with all these wonderful individuals who are great mentors, many, some of whom are still around, a good number I still stay in touch with, and of course my colleagues who were, there were a few other, they were expanding at the time, they hired a few other young guys, and we all became kind of a really enthusiastic group of people doing different projects, and mine was to define really good projects that I could get a better understanding of the processes that allowed ore deposits to form, because ore deposits are a unique geological occurrence. There's, when you think about it, they represent, I don't know what the percentage would be, probably 0.001% of the Earth's surface, and so they're incredibly small and incredible metal enrichments. You know, 10,000 times the background amount of metal sitting in a deposit many times. You figure a gold deposit today typically runs 3 or 4 grams, parts per million, and the background gold is 1 part per billion, so there's 3,000 times concentration right there to make the average grade for most gold deposits. Zinc, the typical zinc content of a basaltic rock is around 80 or 90 parts per million, and a typical zinc deposit will be 6 or 7%, which would be 60 or 70,000. So again, you're looking at 1,000 to, you know, up to 10,000 times concentration of metals. What's the process that allows you to do that? What went on to give you that unique set of circumstances that allows you to form an ore deposit? And from that, if you understand those unique circumstances, those become exploration guidelines for saying, let's look for those in the field, let's look at all of those characteristics and try to find those characteristics that explain the presence of ore deposits as best as you can, and then use those in exploration and continually refine them. So that's what I spent the rest of my life doing.
Okay. Sorry, how big was your team?
I didn't have a team. We all worked by ourselves. Okay. I had graduate students working for me who did thesis work, but as an initial guy, we were all single individuals. We'd go out in the summer with one or two assistants, and that was it. We had tremendous laboratory support in the Geological Survey, so we could get all the work done, you know, microscope support, everything you needed in terms of support, sometimes winter students to help you out as well. But as researchers, we were pretty much expected to do our own research. That has changed, of course, in more recent times, in the last 15, 20 years. It's much more a team approach. When I started there, there was no team approach at all. And so I started back in the survey in 1975, and continued to do that work. They redefined the jobs a bit, and so I became more specialized in one or two ore deposit types, again, largely with the Precambrian Shield, but a little bit more focused on specific types of mineralization that are in the shield as opposed to the more general picture. But again, trying to look at the more extensive geological features. If you take an ore deposit that, let's say the ore body is 500 meters long and 200 meters wide, then its footprint, its, the way in which that the process has affected the rocks, may be 10 times that. It may even be 100 times that, if you understand what the footprint is. And that was my job, is to try to figure out what that footprint is. And so I could, that was my job. And so you looked at all features, you put together what we call a genetic model, a model that explains the presence of an ore deposit. We know that those models are always incorrect in many of their attributes and not as well defined as they need to be, and that's what the research is about. So you're continually bringing all aspects of science to understand component parts of that model. Okay. And that's what we do in research. And in exploration, we use that information to say, okay, I see that old Franklin over there has defined these five characteristics that really explain the presence of this particular type of base metal deposit. And some of those are district scale, and some of those are not much more than deposit scale. So let's start to look for those and see if we can identify them. And if we can find some of those, then that says the area has higher prospectivity, then we go into more intensive work. And eventually bring in geophysical and geochemical studies and do all sorts of things, focus and develop targets, drill them, see what they got.
So were you, were your interests or specializations more in geological surveying that had to do with metals?
Yes.
Okay, so it's
metals and precious metals, yes, okay. Entirely. Nothing to do with hydrocarbons.
Okay.
With uranium, yes, because it's considered a metal, but beyond that, no. Everything was base metals, and my specialty is actually a certain type of deposit called copper. They're called volcanogenic massive sulfide deposits, and they are zinc, lead, copper, silver, gold deposits. All of those elements occur together. The classic examples of those deposits, the largest one you might know of, is the Kid Creek mine at Timmins. It's the largest of its type pretty much in the world in terms of metal content. The entire Naranda camp started out that way, Togami Lake camp, Cyprus, all the mines in Cyprus formed that way. They're all through the various shield areas. British Columbia has a large number of them all through BC, Vancouver Island. And so they are a remarkably abundant, although not super large, set of ore deposits. Spanish Pyrite Belt, another example. Bathurst Camp in Canada is a type of deposit. The curious thing about them is that they formed throughout geological time, and they're actively forming now on the ocean floor.
Okay.
And that's the second part of my research career.
Yes, which I've heard you've done a lot of work underwater.
Yep.
using actually, it says you were one of the first geologists to use deep submersible to study black smokers.
Yep.
Right?
Yep. That happened, that started in about 1981, and they were discovered in 1979, so it was a pretty new thing.
Okay.
You know, you look back on your career and you wonder, how did you ever get into that? A kid from Northern Ontario who'd never been anything larger than a Zodiac on Lake Superior. I had no marine geology training whatsoever, didn't know the front of the boat from the back.
It's a different beast.
It's a different world. And, you know, what it comes down to, and it's an interesting point that affects many, many careers, and most of us kind of forget about it, is that it's often the people you work with that can help create the opportunity that unexpectedly allows you to develop a research career that you never dreamed of. And then this was exactly the case here, that in 1980, I think it was, the director of the Geological Survey took about 50 or 60 of us away in the middle of winter to some cheap tourist lodge down on the St. Lawrence for 3 or 4 days to kind of look forward at where the Geological Survey should go. My job as a relatively young scientist then, I'd only been there 5 or so years, was to look at the future directions of mineral deposits research, which with my colleagues, I put together a talk and I gave what I think was a pretty boring talk, actually, on what we could do. And I finished the talk up, and everybody asked some questions, and the head of our marine branch, a brilliant guy out of Halifax, name was Michael Keane, said, "Why aren't you out looking at black smokers?" And I went sort of, duh. You know, gosh, Mike, I said, that would be an enormous amount of fun, but I don't have any idea how to do it. And it must be really expensive research. That was my entire knowledge of the field. And Mike laughed. Everybody laughed because they thought they couldn't. The picture of some kid from Northern Ontario going to sea was just too much for them. And my boss, the head of the survey, Ray Price, called me up about a week later and he said, "That idea of my camp, look into it." So he said, "Get some of your marine guys from West Coast and East Coast, some of your minerals guys, sit down and think about it." So we did. And we came up with a modest idea for a program off Canadian West Coast with some people out there who had some ideas that there might be some mineralization there. That was all. I mean, we had no bathymetry maps of the West Coast at the time. We had no knowledge of anything about the geology of the undersea out there, other than that, roughly speaking, there was an expansion of the Wiggy's Pacific Rise system had, through many little jogs, ended up as the Wandafuca Rift system about, within Canadian waters, a large part of it, about 300 kilometers offshore, Victoria, or Vancouver Island. And that's all we knew. And so we put together a very modest program to go and search for this, and got lucky. And got lucky in a sense of getting some unexpected sources of funding that we never dreamed of we would get, and unexpected sources of help from a large number of international or national organizations in other countries, particularly the US and France. And that's how I got my career started. In order to get an understanding of how this worked, because I had really no idea, I had been invited to go to a meeting at the Carnegie, or no, at the at the Explorers Club in Washington with a bunch of people to talk about marine minerals. And I didn't have any idea, but I was the only guy they had at the survey, and I was just starting the program, so I went. And I met a bunch of people who seemed to know what they were doing, and one of them was a chap who had worked in the U.S. Navy and was then at Woods Hole and was an incredible enthusiast for technology development on the ocean floor. His name was Bob Ballard, and Ballard found the Titanic eventually, was incredibly helpful to me, and I actually contracted him to come up and give me lessons for several days and some talks to my colleagues on the geopolitics of marine minerals and marine science. And he was spot on in what he told me and gave me some really good guidance for how to develop a career. Meanwhile, I'd written up this really pretty rudimentary program that we were going to try because we didn't have much money. We had ships because the Fisheries and Oceans supplied research vessels so we could get time on them. We had a solid technical group in each of our marine offices who would give me some support with equipment, and the rest of it I could borrow. But the USGS found out that we were doing this and contacted us and said we'd like to do it cooperatively with the Canadian group. I immediately agreed to that, of course, and my first opportunity to go to sea was with the U.S. Geological Survey. I went to sea off the west coast of Newport, Oregon with them, and Astoria, Oregon, rather, and I went off to learn. And I worked with a chap there who was just an enormous teacher of marine geology for me, and so he taught me the ropes. And after a couple of years or so of doing that, I developed our own program. Meanwhile, the second thing that happened in that program was that the assistant deputy minister called me in one day and said, I'd like you to go to Washington. There's a meeting being held at the Carnegie Geophysical Institute on discussing offshore boundaries, the protocols for defining them. And I said, I don't know anything about that. He said, neither do we. That's why we're sending it. They sent me with a lawyer they'd hired from New York, and I went to this meeting. Room about this size, 25 people around it. I'm the only Canadian. Ronald Reagan had just got elected. I had no idea what this was about. We opened the meeting. In came this undersecretary from Interior, who looked down at me, said, you and your tin pot country can go to hell. We, the United States, will define the offshore boundaries. I was young in those days. I was going to get up, but lawyers said, can't do that. So I said, this is unacceptable to the people of Canada. I didn't know what to do, and coffee break came, and now I'm the loneliest guy in the room. Nobody's talking to the Canadian guy. I'm over there drinking my coffee, and a chap came over to see me, very dapper and well-dressed chap, introduced himself to me, and he was head of the Carnegie Geophysical Institute. His name was Hap Yoder. This was the guy who had written the books that I had studied. This was the man that, as a young student, he had redefined the basis of what we call igneous petrology, which is all of the mafic rock, the igneous rocks of the world. And so here was the god talking to the boy. I was a little bit worried that he was going to ask me something out of his papers that I'd read. He said, Dr. Franklin, this is unacceptable, the treatment you got here. I said, I thought it was a bit rough, sir. He said, well, I'm seeing the president next week. I'm going to bring this up. And I said, oh, well, that'd be nice, sir. President of what? He said, I'm seeing the president of the United States. Oh, I said, that'd be nice, sir. I went home and I wrote my report. Never in the annals of government history has a report traveled so quickly through government. It went to my boss. It went up, all the way up the chain. And within 3 days, I was in front of the minister, along with all of the bosses. I was now the boy at the back of the row here, but she had read my report and said, this is not good. We've got to design a science program. Long story short, got $6 million a year for 3 years for my program. That made us the biggest player in the business from nothing. So now all my friends in the U.S. were envious. I talked them into running up some special technology that they had that we did not have, and still don't in Canada, called swath bathymetry. We mapped our offshore ridge system both with scanning sonar to get the detailed bathymetry and something that makes it look like airflow is the ocean floor, and developed that entire data set for nothing. The U.S. government did it for nothing and gave us all the data, and we published it, and which caused a little angst in the U.S. I did have a call from someone in the White House about it to not publish it.
You did their coast as well.
No, they did theirs themselves. They couldn't publish theirs. We published ours. There was a concern about security, and I got a chap from the White House called me up. His name was Andrew Poindexter. He was involved in the Iran-Contra scandal eventually, and asked me not to publish it. I gave him a line of BS and said, you got to talk to the boss. I said, you work for the Secretary of Defense. I said, tell him, call the Minister of Defense in Canada, and he'll talk to his colleague over in Arcan, and they'll tell me not to do it. They won't do it, sir. But I was working. Yeah. Well, anyway, we published the maps, and they were an enormous advantage to us, and we had this wonderful data set. We went out and we found several of these, what we call hydrothermal systems operating. And one of them, which one of my colleagues had documented as part of his PhD in a geophysical study he had done out there, one of them turned out to have a giant deposit, which we drilled with the ocean drilling program. So the program lasted 10 years. I started out doing deep submergence diving on a number of these systems with my U.S. colleagues, and the French got onto this, and I went out with it for Mare as well, did some work on the Galapagos River. And then eventually we isolated one system that we really felt was worthy of extensive research called Middle Valley. And it was, it had some unique geological characteristics that made it a relatively easier place to work. And we had no idea of how large the deposit was that we found there. We found occurrences, we found active forming systems. We went out with the ocean drilling program after we managed to sell the program to them and drilled it, and it turned out to be quite a large deposit. And it's still sitting there, of course, because it's underneath the sediments, but it was a wonderful natural laboratory. All of that work, not just the work that we did, although it was a major program, but all of the other work that was going on in the world, really advanced our knowledge of the process of the systems that make these deposits, because now we can study them in real time. So amongst other things, I drilled a 1,000 meter hole underneath this system, and that got me into rocks that were at well over 300 degrees C, and that was what we call the reaction zone, where the metals were coming out of the rocks and going into solution. Nobody has ever done that since, and that proved the concept of one part of this model I talked about how these deposits form. So we learned a lot about how all of this worked, and collected some amazing samples, got a lot of really cool research done, and that went on up until the early 90s, when there were a lot of changes in the government of Canada and redirections, and we had come to kind of a plateau in that kind of research, and my career then changed again at that stage, and so I moved out of research for the rest of my career at the GSC, starting around 91 or so, and became chief geologist, and that was a different set of challenges. But nevertheless, it was an amazing opportunity, one which in my wildest dreams I would never have dreamed of doing. It was the defining moment in my career, there's no doubt. But at the same time, I was still operating on land with other projects, and taking some of that knowledge, and I still do this. I mean, we've learned things out of that work that we still haven't published, and which we can go back and re-examine the samples and learn more from. And so, because the samples are all very carefully archived, mm-hmm. And so it was an enormously good project.
And has your work been or become fruitful for natural resources, natural resource industries?
Oh yes, because we validated the concepts. We validated the model. We said, this is real. When I can see it in real time, when I can explain to you why this one is gold rich and that one's not, then that's an enormous, you know, and when I know exactly why that is, then that constrains your geological work to say, we only want to work if we're looking for gold rich deposits of that type. We only want to work in that kind of terrain. And that particular one, the gold thing, is as simple as the depth of water. They only form in relatively shallow water. The water in these systems has to boil. And the chemistry that underpins that is quite advanced, thermodynamic-based chemistry. And that you have to know. That's part of what we do. And so all of the chemical parameters that are basically physical chemistry that underpin this were known. But suddenly, we had a real-time, real-life system operating there that we could go in with the submarine and sample that actual water that makes the deposits before it cools off. And we proved the concept. And it's a little bit of not very tricky chemistry, actually, that everybody would have said, well, duh, yeah, that's right. But this actually works. And so now the trick, of course, is how do you know what the water depth is in a bunch of 2.7 billion year old rocks that we would have in the Precambrian Shield? That's a little harder thing.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah, but you know, it sets the stage. We now know other things about certain characteristics of these rocks that are only attendant on relatively shallow water features. And so we start to look for those in our geological mapping. And so there are indirect ways of getting at this. It's one of the great unknowns in terms of specifically calibrating water depth. We aren't very good at that yet. But we have methods that are coming along that help us with that. And that's just one of the many, many features. that hot water, as it comes out, obviously does bad things to all of the rocks through which it's passing. And those bad things provide very good guidelines also to exploration. So that's another thing we learned. And we can calibrate them, see them in real time, know what the relationships are. So it was a great, great experience. It's still going on today. I had a colleague at the University of Toronto, Steve Scott, who did a lot of the work, and Steve deserves a lot of credit for having been a constant driver in on the academic side for this. And one of his graduate students, who I snapped up and hired right away, Mark Hannington, who's a prof at Ottawa U now, but worked with us in the Geological Survey, continues on. And Mark, as we speak, is at sea. So there's a lot of that work carrying on today. And I still stay involved a little bit, vicariously. And I haven't been to sea since 98. That was my last, I retired in 98, and that was my last shot. The boys took me back to sea off New Guinea for a very interesting thing. But I've stayed involved in one little piece of technology that we developed uniquely in Canada back in the late 80s that had never been done before. I stayed on its board up until March. I just retired. And that's a full ocean depth remotely operated vehicle. It had never been done. The oil industry did it, but they dropped it straight down below oil platforms. We wanted to develop one that you could drive around on the ocean floor. It'd have to be tethered initially, but we wanted to be able to collect samples, take movies, collect water samples, heart samples, mud samples, whatever we wanted, and be able to do this for extended periods of time and know exactly where the vehicle is and be able to get it back up and get the samples back up. A group in Vancouver who built these sumps for the oil business said they would like to give it a try. There was a government program called the Unsolicited Proposal Program. It wasn't too unsolicited, I must say. We kind of got them to propose the idea. The Department of Supply and Service put up a large amount of money together with NRCan and Fisheries and Oceans. We built the very first underwater deep submergence vehicle with 5 kilometers possible water depth. We put it on one of the very first ever fiber optic systems for its tether. Nobody had ever tried that before. Paid $1 million for the 5 kilometer fiber optic cable, first one. Got it to work, and I was the first guy who ever took it to sea and got it to the bottom of the ocean.
Yeah.
And damn near lost it the first day.
And that was in 89?
That was probably 88 or 89, but before we drilled Middle Valley in 91, so it would have been 88, 89 when we got it down there. That vehicle has undergone many, many revisions, changes, upgrades, and it still operates today. Government didn't want to run it anymore, so a group of us bought it for a buck and put it into a not-for-profit corporation. We run it as the Canadian Scientific Submersible Facility out of Victoria, and we have an excellent team of engineers who run it. We're the guys who recovered the data box from the Queen of the North Ferry when it sank. We also got the hard drive out of the computer. We went through the bridge window and got them out. That was pretty cool. We developed for that. Extended the arm, broke the window out, went in and undid the bolts, and it's all done remotely with a tactile hand. So it's really cool technology. If you're ever out there, you want to go and have a look. It's really pretty cool. So we did that, and that continues today. It's mainly for research purposes. A lot of biology stuff. Of course, now we've put a powered fiber optic network out in the ocean. I was on the board for that. We developed called Project Neptune. That collects real-time data on the ocean floor now. University of Victoria operates that as a facility for Canada. And we were the first people in the world to do that as well. And so it was pretty cool. So I keep a little bit involved with that stuff. It's for fun.
And throughout your long buried career, what would have been your hardest task or biggest challenge? Or project?
Scientific or otherwise?
Both. Can be both.
Scientific, I would say in some respects the hardest challenge was to really put together that marine program. Because we had no knowledge.
In the U.S.
Yeah, because I had to borrow a camera system from Lamont Doherty. We didn't have one in Canada. Fortunately, I knew a prof down there, and he came up with a system, and his grad students ran it for us, and I bought the thing from him. Still sits out there in Victoria. Building the equipment we needed to be able to do that sampling, it had never been done, a lot of that. We realized that we had to be able to protect the samples the minute we got them on board, so we had to build, for example, a nitrogen atmosphere glove box to be able to seal them up to save them from getting oxidized. We had to learn how to do the analytical work on these things, because we really didn't know how. We had to develop specialized methods for all of that. We were right at the front end. Nobody had done any of this before. Everything that had been done up to that point because we started, I remember, in the early 80s with this and developed this whole program, and the work before that was just kind of a glorified prospecting. We found another one, but nobody did much with it. So we had to develop the water samplers, we had to develop all of the, borrow or get technology from people like NOAA, very helpful. The NOAA guys really helped us enormously with subtime, with all sorts of things, with technology, with loaning us equipment and allowing us to build our own. And so, you know, it was a truly collaborative effort between NOAA, the USGS, ourselves, IFREMER in France, and the universities, of course. And so it was great. But that was scientifically probably the hardest thing to do in many respects.
So,
and also it was one of the very first team efforts, because it wasn't me, I was the head of this project, but my colleagues were the meat and potatoes of it. They were the hard workers, the guys that were out there actually doing this. And I had a good, solid, excellent team of people, both from the Geological Survey and through the universities out there working with me. So that's what really made it. And they were an enormously enthusiastic bunch of people. So that was scientifically probably the most difficult thing. You know, a lot of fun, interesting as heck, but not trivial. Just, you know, I had to get the machine shop at the Geological Survey to build me stuff, and I had no clue what I was doing. I had tremendous support from really good engineers who work in government and elsewhere, so that was out. So from a science point of view, that was the hardest thing I ever did. The hardest thing I had to do politically, or not politically, but managerially, was lay off one-third of the staff of the Geological Survey of Canada. And that was completely unpleasant. And that was due to the Martin downsizing. As you know, Paul Martin and the government of Canada decided that we were spending too much money. They were quite correct about that. And so, rather than nickel and dime away, Martin said, we're going to review every program in the government, and we're going to downsize by anywhere from 50% on down. And I was taken out of the Geological Survey and put in charge of figuring out how to downsize science in Natural Resources Canada. That caused me to have to learn about forestry, about mining technology, about geography, about the whole map making, all of those components, and figure out how to value the program. And that was not easy. It was challenging, there's no question.
Yeah.
It was
brutal
to have to do it. And I answered directly to the deputy minister and the minister at the time, was Anne McClellan, for that. But it had to be done. And, you know, I had lots of my colleagues saying, you know, why are you beating up on us? Well, I wasn't beating up on us. I was trying to figure out how to do this in a way that would least affect the value of the organization to Canadians, which is the key thing. If you're going to have a government organization, it has to have value to Canadians. And so that's how we evaluated the program. Which components had the greatest value to Canadians? Which components could be done somewhere else? Which components could be done in the private sector? So we reviewed every part of our agency, as every other government agency did. And so, you know, in the Geological Survey alone, there were 8 components. In CanMet, there were 8 components. In forestry, there were 8 components. Each one specific targeted component that defined the whole organization. And then we evaluated it against 5 or 6 criteria that the government set. And then we inter-evaluated all of those and put them into rank order. And my job was to figure out what had to go. And, you know, what had to go was not just program, but it was people. Fortunately, the government managed it in such a way that they came in with a wonderful downsizing program for senior people. So that if you had more than 25 years experience in, and you were under 55, you could go out with, respectively, no reduced pension. Guess who took the deal on the third last day? You had to be over 55, that's right. I was 1 month over 55 and 3 days short of 30 years, which is the other rule. You can't be over 30 years. I retired in 98. I had 30 years in. And I thought, what the heck, I'm young enough to do something else. And I'm burned out from doing this program. I mean, it was not pleasant. I had a lot. But, you know, we affected most of the downsizing by retirements. And so it wasn't personally as difficult as it might have been. And the government was very fair to all of us and said, if you want to come back and continue your science, keep your office, we'll keep the budget a little bit, you know, we'll do the best we can for you, just you're now being paid by Pensions Canada or whatever they're called. Yeah, you know, okay. Your pensions paying you, we're not. And fair enough, a lot of guys took that option. Some, I had breakfast with one of the guys today, he still goes back. And he's 74 and he's back and helped curate the samples and things. You know, so, you know, it was humane in the sense it had to be done. And at the end of the day, although I don't think we did as good a job as we might have, you always look back and know it could have been better, but we did the best we could. And that was most unpleasant. So in 98, I found myself, you know, done in a sense. I thought, well, I'll give this consulting gig a little try and do a little university stuff. And the consulting gig worked out to something rather well. And that's always been good fun.
Yeah, and what do you, it's a recurring theme with the people I interview is, although some are at a typical age of where they should be retired.
That's right.
Or not do any work.
Yeah.
They continue working.
And the thing
a lot
is,
of them in consulting.
Yes.
What's your consulting?
I consult in exactly what I did at the Geological Survey, and that is, but on the opposite side of the table, I now use and develop those criteria to help find ore deposits.
Okay.
And it's as simple as that. What I offer and a group of us offer that's somewhat unique is we bridge that gap between the academic and the applied. And so the guys in universities who are doing curiosity-driven research, by definition, that's where it should be done. A lot of it is targeted, but that's their job. They go out and they pursue knowledge, and they do a very good job at that. My colleagues in the Geological Survey are perhaps a little more applied, but looking at things at a bigger scale and generating a lot of data. My job now is to be the link between that enormous knowledge-generating capacity we have in Canada, universities and government, and the industry side, which can't afford to generate that knowledge, and in many respects, particularly the junior mining industry, can't even afford to have people read literature. So my job is to bring the best ideas I can to that, design how to test those out, maybe execute some of those tests, help them with what they need help with. Small companies, sometimes it's as simple as getting their rock types right. Big companies, it's very complex problems that are beyond the capacity of what they can do and require, for example, a lot of advanced statistical stuff, a lot of advanced chemistry, a lot of advanced understanding of what controls the chemistry. And so I have to, that's what I do for them. And the objective, of course, is to design something that works, hopefully it's successful, and if it is, then you say, here's what I did, here's how you do it, here's the software you need, here's the knowledge you need to be able to do it, the training you need, see ya, you can do it yourself.
What's an example of a fairly big project that you helped to...
There's a number of them, but I'll give you the example of one they probably heard of, which is the Ring of Fire, the chromite discovery in the Ring of Fire. Now, what happened was that a small company based in Toronto called Spider Resources was looking for diamonds up in the Hudson's Bay Lowlands, had, with their partner, which was De Beers, drilled what De Beers called copper in schist, which is about as undefined as you're going to find, turned it over to Spider, who were a small company with some top-notch guys who were diamond specialists, and called me and said, could you look at this drill core? Tell us what this is. So I looked at it and I said, yes, I know exactly what this is. Here's what it is. Here's what you can do with this, and here's how these things occur, and maybe here's some ideas for what you can do next. And so they took me seriously, and we did that. And we designed a program. I designed a program for them to look for more of these base metal occurrences, which were these copper zinc things I was telling you about, these massive sulfide deposits. We found a second one. Now, as you're probably aware, that's Bay Lowlands is the world's largest swamp. There is no outcrop. There are no rocks to be seen anywhere. It's all covered by either Paleozoic cover or a gigantic swamp. And so you have to use remote sensing. There's not a whole lot that works, but there are some things that do. And one of them was a magnetic survey. So these guys had magnetics data. These little occurrences that we found had a distinct magnetic signal. Problem with those magnetic signals is they're not unique. They're there, but they can be other things. And so they, we drilled a couple of these. We found a third one. They drilled it, and they got 1 meter of what we call chromite, which is the chrome ore. And in discussing it with them, the guy said, well, you know, what do we do with that? I knew the rock type, and I knew the system they were in geologically, and it was the one that can have significant chrome. geophysically, there's only one method that works for chrome, and it turns out to be gravity, which is not an easy one to use, because when you measure the gravity signal, you're measuring the whole Earth gravity signal, but you're looking for a tiny signal near the surface. But there are ways the geophysicists have of interpreting that data, so we were able to do that. And I said, look, let's run a gravity traverse over this, see if we can pick up the 1 meter, but make it a long line, because it's swamp, it's easy. And so they did, and they got a nice little bump over the one line, and a nice big bump right next to it. It was 100 meters of direct shifted chrome ore. That became the what was called the Big Daddy discovery, and this thing was incredibly well behaved geologically. The guys who had the property next door picked it up as well, and we found a world-class, very high-grade chrome deposit. Both of us, my company, Spider Resources, and Free West, the ones next door, who I also was consulting for under a joint arrangement with everybody, got bought out by Cliffs, and that was...
You probably made a fortune.
Right, yeah, I did all right.
Did well, right?
Yeah, I did well, yeah.
And then Spider?
Spider, we all did. I mean, We all went away with big smiles.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, I got to say, that was 2010, and that was a good deal.
Excellent.
But, and you know, I've had a couple of others of those, one early in my career. Helped find a mine for Miranda that got rid of my mortgage forever, and that was a nice deal. You know, it helped. It was, again, it was the application of basic science principles and the thing that I had learned in studying their deposit, and that was kind of satisfying. You know, I learned a little chemical trick that we could explain the presence of the deposits, and I targeted some drilling for them in an area that was completely unknown, simply to get some geological information. They were not keen to do that, because my targeting was based on one outcrop a long ways away with one sample that showed an anomalous condition in a related element, not even the base metals. We drilled it, and the first hole found a mine, and I was lucky, completely lucky, but that helped. I was still living in Thunder Bay then, I was still teaching at that stage. Okay. That all worked out, and I've had a couple others like that. And you know, there's no success that you could say is attributed to an individual in this business. It's all teamwork. And it was the same with the chrome mine business. I mean, I made my comments. I helped support the company. The company had good geologists who knew what to do and how to handle the rocks. And so then I was actually able to bring in a better expert than myself to help them develop that particular site. And then eventually another company that was also somewhat related to us found a major nickel deposit there. Noron, the company, is, and they're pushing hard to develop that. So it's a fascinating place. And it's a fascinating place because it has a mineral resource inventory that's been developed in 10 years that is remarkable. And what it all says is that this is a new, probably really major mining district for Canada. It's just, unfortunately, in the world's largest swamp and 300 kilometers from infrastructure. So it's going to take some time to get all of the issues sorted out with building the infrastructure, dealing with the First Nations issues there, which are quite important and have to be dealt with. And so it'll take some time, but you know, it will eventually happen. And,
yeah, I mean, we've done it in more difficult spots.
We have, you know, I
the Arctic.
Tecumenco's old mine up on Little Cornwallis Island, and you can't get more remote than Little Cornwallis Island. And they were certainly making money mining that thing. It was remarkable what they were doing. You know, I've worked on a number of Arctic projects, that one of which was a mine, a Lupin mine, and others of which are getting close, that are in very remote areas. Agnico Eagle run the Meadowbank mine that's 100 kilometers north of Baker Lake. They built a road, and there they go, they're mining, they're doing quite well. They just found a new major discovery just north of it. So, you know, it will happen, and it takes time, it takes big discoveries, and it takes support from governments and local people to do this, but it's important, and that's the fun I have, is helping these guys. You know, I do some work for all of those companies, and I give them ideas, some of which work, some of which don't, and try to bring them the right expertise, because it's a broad field, and you need good geophysicists, sometimes different types of geochemists, and so you do that sort of thing. So I've had some interesting successes.
What would you consider, well, this is often a tough question, so I'll split it in two.
Sure.
Kind of like we did a while ago, the scientific and the managerial. But what are you proudest of in life? And we could say one career-wise.
Well, career-wise, I guess it's the contributions I've made. There's one other thing that I was involved in doing that I've been quite proud of, and you may be aware of it. Back in just about the time I was retiring and just after, a group of us got together here in Ottawa to form something called the Partnership Group for Science and Engineering. And I was representing Canada's geoscientists on it because I was a past president of the Geological Association of Canada. And the meeting was being held over at Ottawa U. And the vice director of research there, Howard Halper, was chairing it. And we decided that we needed a collectivity to effectively lobby government on behalf of the science societies of Canada, Canadian Federation of Biologists, et cetera, et cetera, and we were all members of this thing, to lobby for better funding for research in Canada. So we had a single objective, and that's what it was. I was asked, for reasons I'll never understand, to try to figure out how we could communicate science better with members of Parliament. So I got a bunch of local MPs that I didn't really know very well together for lunch or coffee or something one day and said, here's my challenge, guys. Have you got any ideas? And their response was interesting. And they said, you know, you science guys, you talk a funny language. You're putting one over us on us with that funny language. And I said, you know, if that's what you think we do, then our work is cut out for us because we don't do that intentionally. But yes, we do that. I know that because I've experienced it on the other side of the camera on occasion when I've done interviews and people say, you know, get off the technical jargon, Frank, don't tell us what the hell this is. So I decided to set something up called Bacon and Eggheads. One of my committee members made that suggestion. He's a guy from agriculture, unfortunately I can't remember his name. And he said, you know, number one, we're going to call it that because we've got to laugh at ourselves. And Bacon and Eggheads, you smiled, everybody does when I say that. And we decided what we would do is we would put on a science talk on Parliament Hill once a month, and we would do it as a breakfast meeting, and we did it on one month, Thursday morning, which is committee day on the Hill. We knew that people didn't have to go to the committees till 9, so we put a 7:30 breakfast on, talk at 8, half hour, carefully scripted talk, no technical terms. What's the value of what your science is to Canada? What's the excitement of what you found? I can tell you we have no shortage of people wanting to give the talks. We vetted it and still do. I'm not doing it. I did it for 4 or 5 years and then I turned it over to other people. I'm still going today. NSERC was incredibly supportive. They actually provided us with one of their public relations guys to vet the talks, to help us to make sure they were not too technical, to keep them to that half hour and to make them funny and a little deprecating, self-deprecating at times because we guys tend to, you know, guys with PhDs have room-filling egos, that's part of our mantra, and you know, you got to get off it sometimes, and sometimes you do make screw-ups, sometimes you do learn the hard way, or sometimes you accidentally make a discovery, and all of that's fair, but the important thing is that the science needs support. So we started the Bacon and Eggheads talks, and I was the first chairman, and I started out getting 35 people, now they get 150, and
Is it only members of Parliament, or is it
no?
Anybody?
It's open to the public. It's okay. Open to everybody. Members of Parliament, senators and members of Parliament get a free breakfast, as do members of the press. And we had to round some money up to pay for that. We did. That took almost no effort back in that time because there were some very, very large companies that were very keen on supporting science. We would never attribute who they were because we did not want to be appearing. So who those companies were. But we don't to this day say who they were.
Yeah. Anonymous donations.
They're anonymous donations, but they were large. They were $50,000 each. They bought a lot of breakfast, and they've topped it up from time to time, and that's what buys the breakfasts. And we use the parliamentary restaurant to supply them. We did them in the West Block in Room 100 up until they renovated. Started renovated. Now they do it over in the train station. Now I hear they're going to renovate that. I'm not quite sure where we're going to go next.
That center block is on its way too.
Yeah. So yeah. We may get kicked out. But anyway, it worked out enormously well. And I actually gave a talk to the thing about 2 or 3 years ago. And Finance Minister Mr. Flaherty turned up to my talk and then immediately renewed the flow-through share deal. So, you know, not that I'm sure that my talk had anything to do with it. My talk was on future directions for research that underpin exploration, which is what I do. But you know, we've had everything. We had robotics, we've done astronaut, and Mark Garneau was a speaker once before he became a politician. You know, we've had people doing telescopes, we had medical, we don't do a lot of medical stuff, but some, and some really cool stuff, actually. And the idea is to get the members of Parliament enthusiastic about science. I gotta say that was the easiest sell ever. the members of Parliament may not be scientists, but they're pretty bright folks. And they really took to this. And I had one or two of the members of Parliament who started to study up before them. The one that surprised me the most was Preston Manning, who would come with the best ever questions. He had really looked up stuff and came and asked some very did his homework, you know. But they all did. I found that it was quite remarkable how engaged members of Parliament would get and how they'd remain engaged and interested. And what we always did was to try to get the person's member of Parliament, if they were from outside the Ottawa area, which most were, to introduce them. And that way we connected the scientist with their member of Parliament and got them interested. Gosh, you know, there's a person in my constituency that's doing this work. So it's been a real success and continues to be. And so you're welcome to go. You know, the offices, they have a one person, part-time person that runs it, Donna Bogue, her name is, and she works out of the Royal Society offices.
What are they called officially?
They're called the Partnership Group for Science and Engineering.
Okay.
Email me and I can send you a contact. She'll put you on the mailing list. And
interesting.
And you have to register the night before because of security reasons now, but it's not a big deal. It's good fun and interesting.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, anyway.
That is quite
interesting. So the fact that I was involved in doing that.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, I'd done lots of other stuff with professional societies and things that have always, you know, always resulted in good things for students, for other things. I started a foundation in Canada for the Society of Economic Geologists to support students, and we support enormously, almost virtually every graduate student in our field gets support from them now in Canada, and because industry puts up the money, and we all put up money, and half of us have written them into our wills, and so, you know, organizations like that, but those are always team efforts. You know, I was the guy that negotiated the legal framework for the Canadian one, because I'm a former bureaucrat, and I knew how to never take no from some bureaucrat at CRA and say, here's what we're doing, tell me how I get there, and that's what you do. You know, and we got the thing going, and it's worked out really well. I sat on its board for many, many years. And retired from that. You get worn out after a while and do these. So you get asked to do lots and lots of these kinds of things as a now kind of older scientist in the business. And if you can give back, fine. And when you're not giving back, you know what's going to happen. They're not going to call you anymore, and that's fine too.
Sometimes it's important also to take some time off.
Well, I do. We do. My wife and I do. My wife retired. She was an assistant deputy minister in the health department, and her last major job was that she started up and then operated, ran, and coordinated the Canada's Pesticide Agency, which was amalgamating parts of three or four government departments. And she did that and got it going, and then retired probably 10 or 12 years ago now. She runs a little company based in Washington called Lifeline, and it does human health-related toxicology studies. And it's really cool what they're doing, and so that's another thing. You know, you got to keep engaged. We have one daughter, and she's off doing her thing at USC.
California.
Last
question for you.
Sure.
One of my favorites. If you were to talk to someone much younger, myself or students, what would be your one piece of piece of advice or the most important life lesson you could give?
Oh, that's easy. Simply do what you are most interested in. If you can't figure that out, then invest some time, and that may be an extra year or two of university, as both you and I have done, and many people have done. Invest some extra time to search out what that might be. My daughter started out in music at McGill, ended up in chemistry and math. Finally got a Ph.D. in statistics from Harvard, okay? Now that's a big shift, okay? She had no clue what she wanted to do. She loved playing the trumpet. She was a classical trumpet player. She would have loved a career in that. You know how many jobs there are in North America a year for a classical trumpet player? You know, if you're not Wynton Marsalis, you're not getting the job.
Yeah.
You know, she realized that early on and said, this is fine, but this isn't really my passion either. And math turned out to be her passion. So it goes, you know? And I tell that to everybody. Because if you're not enjoying life, look for something else, if you can afford to look for something else.
Yeah.
But so that's the thing. I fell into geology. And I fell into geology because I like the outdoors. Other people, you know, one of the things that bothers me quite a lot is that people aren't curious enough about the Earth. And I fault the fact that we don't teach Earth science at an early enough stage in school, and that the people who do teach it may not have the background to excite the students. You know, I taught first year geology when I started teaching. And on the very first day of my class, I gave them an exam. I said, if you get 100 on the exam, you're done. You got an A in the course, you have to take it. And I was teaching in Thunder Bay. And so I said, when was the last magnitude 6.5 or 7 earthquake in the Thunder Bay area? That was the first question. When was the last major volcanic eruption in the Thunder Bay area? And what's underneath the Kaministiqua River that runs right through the town? Those are the questions I asked. You never saw 120 more frantic students in your life trying to figure out the answer and whip it through the textbook, which of course didn't have the answer to any of those. And then I said, okay, anybody get any answers? And nobody did, of course, ever. But then I said, let me tell you the answers. And let me tell you about what happened 1 billion years ago, just out in front of Thunder Bay here, when the whole of Lake Superior ripped apart into a gigantic intracratonic rift and dumped out incredible volumes of volcanic rock. And nothing has happened to them since.
Yeah.
And there they sit. You go out on those rocks on the islands of Lake Superior, they look like Hawaii. Nothing has ever changed. You look at the rocks that sit under them, they have the earliest, best preserved life forms in the world in the Dunfield Formation. 1.8 billion years old, you make a microscope slide of those, you can still see the cell structures, and if you're lucky, you'll catch them mitotically splitting. So, 1.8 billion years old. How many people knew that in my class? Of course,
yeah.
How many people know that at all? You know,
yeah.
You know, how many people in Thunder Bay know that, you know, and so, see, we need to excite people about this, about things like this, and you can't do it with a set of boring lectures, and you can't do it necessarily in a first year course. And now with television, we do a lot better. There are lots of great programs that get into that a bit more. Unfortunately, I think the only people who watch them are old guys like me, but maybe that's unfair. But I think it we need to do better at that, and it starts in grade one.
Yeah, for sure.
You know,
I used to be addicted to Discovery Channel. And,
yeah,
and,
exactly.
Documentaries about animals and
yeah.
And space and
yeah.
At a very young age.
Exactly, and I think that's important. But I think it's important to have it structured into the education. You know, what's the Earth made of? You know, I remember one of my other little interesting deviations was back in the late 70s, just after, actually it was in the early 80s, after the moonshots, the very first ones, I was asked to go to NASA in Houston and spend some time trying to figure out what's next for NASA. And we came up with a mission to planet Earth, resulting in the shuttle. That was a lot of fun. But it was... I asked, why did you invite me to come to this meeting? And they said, well, you gave us a field trip one time up in northwestern Ontario to look at one of these base metal deposits, and you explained that 2.7 billion years ago, there were gigantic 400-degree hot springs spewing out metals onto the bottom of the ocean floor. We didn't know that. And so when I went down, the very first thing I did was they had a group of 100 of us that they hid away in the hills of Virginia for a whole week. We had to contemplate things. And the first thing, they broke us into little working groups, and the first thing I had to do with a group of 5 of us was to estimate the potential for discovery of resources on Io, which is one of the moons of Jupiter. Think about that. You figure, what's the fundamental thing that a planet has to have in order for it to have resources? What's the number one thing? It has to be a differentiated planet. It has to have a core, a mantle, and a crust. How many planets have that? Well, the NASA guys seem to know something about that, you know, and there are ways of figuring that out. One of them is really volcanic active. But you know, so it goes, you see, and so that's at the biggest scale, the number one question you would ask. If you were, somebody said, I want you to go out to the planetary system and find another resource-rich Earth, you know, well, that's the first criteria, you tick them off, you know.
Yeah.
And so that's getting people curious about the science. And that's the critical thing. And not all scientists are good at it, and that's not a failing at all. It is important, though, that those who can communicate well, and people like Ballard and others who have done a good job at that, you know, the Quirks and Quarks guy and Bob McDonald, who does that now, and his predecessor. I've done Quirks and Quarks a couple of times back in the day, and these guys are really good at getting the curiosity part of science out there and the latest discoveries. And that's the critical thing. And I think, you know, we need to somehow get that into the school level. So it isn't a choice, it's kind of an exposure. You know, I didn't have a choice to read Shakespeare, you know, and I probably wouldn't have taken it, you know, although I look back on it and say, that enriched me. But on the other hand, learning about the earth by somebody who's enthusiastic and can explain it well is important.
It's all about a good teacher.
Yeah, and, you know, going to the field. I mean, I'll tell you, teaching at Thunder Bay, you couldn't pick a better place to go to the field. It had every geological process you wanted within a half day.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, that's, and that's a good part of teaching and training and getting people excited.
Well, anyway, Dr. Franklin, thanks a lot.
Okay, you bet.
Appreciate it.
Here we are at 4 o'clock.